الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين. اللهم اجعلنا منهم ومن الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. آمين يا رب العالمين. أما بعد, yesterday I sort of left you with a bit of a riddle. The entire scene that I painted for you of the Prophet ﷺ heading back and being overjoyed at the revelation of Surah Al-Fath, describing Allah describing it as the most open, unequivocal victory. Inna fatahna laka fatham mubina. And by the way, it's not that we will give you a victory, we already have given you a victory. That's actually what Allah says. So it's in the past tense. So it's understandable that there are two dimensions of that. In the Arabic language, when you talk about something that's guaranteed in the future, then you still use the past, which is kind of something like English when you say, consider it done. Consider it done doesn't mean it's done yet, but it's as good as done. You see? So you're using the word done, which is in the past, but you're talking about something that is guaranteed to happen in the future, right? So let's first talk about the politics of all of this and get that out of the way. You see, all this time, the Quraysh saw, first they saw the Prophet ﷺ as someone insane. They saw him later on as someone who has some kind of agenda. You know, he's got something up his sleeve. He's trying to stir trouble. You know, he's trying to pit brother against brother, father against son, etc., etc. Then later on, they saw him as a threat to the tribe, you know. And they basically considered him and all of those who followed him outlaws. Their biggest complaint was, he is hurting the unity of Makkah. He's hurting the unity of the leadership. That's what their problem was with the Prophet ﷺ. So they never acknowledged the Muslims as a legitimate group. They just considered them criminals, really. Outlaws, you know, that are a threat to the nation and a threat to the tribe. So even when they went to war with the Muslims, it's because they're going to war with those that have rebelled against them, rebels, outlaws. But now for the first time, when this negotiation that I referred to briefly happened with Suhail, and you know, Suhail ibn Amr, and then who's the father of Abu Jandal, I mentioned Abu Jandal yesterday to you, the one who came running away, his father's name is Suhail, he's the one who was negotiating. He was basically, if he was alive today, he'd be on Fox News. That was the guy, right? He was a very good negotiator, debater, very loud, very aggressive. And he was the one negotiating on behalf of the Meccans. But the fact that this negotiation is happening, number one, if you consider somebody criminal, then you don't negotiate with them. You don't make treaties with them. You don't sign a document with them. The fact that they're signing a document with the Muslims actually meant that for the first time, the Quraysh have acknowledged the Muslims as a legitimate government of their own. So that legitimized the Muslims in the eyes of the entire region. You see, the most important people, the most powerful political people in all of Arabia were the people of Mecca. So if the people of Mecca are signing a paper alongside another group, then that group becomes super important. Now the thing is, in all of Mecca, just a year before I told you, remember how the Quraysh gathered everybody to try to kill the Muslims? So they gathered people from all these different tribes. Those tribes were not necessarily enemies of Islam. But they figured, hey, if the Quraysh is calling us, it's going to be expensive for us to send our soldiers and take our horses and go into Medina and attack Medina. It'll be expensive, but once we kill everybody in Medina, we'll make a lot of money. So they weren't interested in destroying Islam, they were interested in making money. That's what it was. But that didn't work. They stayed outside Medina, the invasion of Medina didn't happen, and they had to go back. All that money was lost. But not only was that money lost, they lost the credibility they used to have for Mecca. Next time Mecca asks them to do something, they're not going to do it. Next time Quraysh says, hey, want to come along with us? They're not going to listen anymore. Moreover, a year ago, we were ready to kill these people in their own city. A year later, they show up unarmed at the throat of Quraysh, and the Quraysh is so scared that they signed a treaty. So who's this? I think we were backing the wrong horse here. We were backing the wrong side. These guys are so powerful, even the Quraysh are scared of them. And these guys are so fearless that they left their homes unarmed and showed up at the enemy's door. They don't even care. So this, what this did, when this peace treaty happened, by the way, this is now years of no war. We will not fight each other, right? And in this time, all these different tribes that used to not, they weren't sure what's going on. Now all of a sudden, they have huge respect for the Muslims. They have huge respect for them. And now tribes after tribes after tribes are coming in and starting to accept Islam. Because, you know, for legitimate da'wah reasons, but also they see this is the new big power. So if you look at a map of Arabia before Hudaybiyah, the map of Arabia, if the Quraysh are colored a certain way, you know how they have election maps in blue and red with Democrats and Republicans and things like that? If the Quraysh were a certain color, then most of the map was their color. And some of it was the Muslim color, let's say white. But because of Hudaybiyah, now the influence of the Muslims is increasing, you know? And the Quraysh are now getting choked. Their influence is getting reduced and reduced and reduced and reduced. That's actually what happened. And in that sense, this was already a massive victory for the Muslims. Now they didn't have to convince other tribes to come and accept Islam. Other tribes were coming over to the Prophet ﷺ to accept Islam. And when a tribe leader comes and accepts Islam, you know what that means? The whole tribe is following. Right? So this is called Amul Wufud, the year of delegations. People would come every year, every now and then, groups would come to meet with the Prophet ﷺ, and entire tribes would become Muslim. So yeah, at face value, it looked like we couldn't even make Hajj. We had to go back frustrated. But the victory that came to Islam as a result, that was guaranteed already, was bigger than any battle could have given us. It was bigger than any battle. So from a political standpoint, this was absolutely incredible as an advantage to the Muslims. But the Quran mentions all of this, meaning what I just described to you, the political gains. All of this is described as أُخْرَى لَمْ تَقْدِرُوا عَلَيْهَا قَدْ أَحَاطَ اللَّهُ بِهَا. Other than this actual victory, secondary, second status, some things you haven't had power over yet, Allah has encircled that for you, given it to you. In other words, the political gains of Islam and the political gains of the Muslims and the Muslim population increasing, Allah considers that victory number two, but not number one. Something else is the top victory as far as Allah is concerned. And so that's what he describes at this final ayah of Surah Al-Fath. And to help you understand that, let's talk a little bit about frustration. How many people here have gone to Hajj? Okay, if you've gone to Hajj, you spend a lot of money. It's very difficult to secure the package and all of that. It's not an easy trip. And you have to say goodbye to your family and pack and all these concerns. And of course, the lines at the airport. And when we go from the United States, actually, we have an easier time. You show an American passport, you get a little bit easier time. You go with a Pakistani passport, a Bangladeshi passport, a Sri Lankan passport, you know how you're going to get treated, right? And so when you go and you see these people in the camps and you see, people standing in long, long lines waiting to get their passport stamped and all of this other stuff, difficulty. Now imagine even if you don't have those difficulties, somebody goes from here, from Texas or from New York or California, they go and they make it all the way to Jeddah, right? Man, that was a long flight. We had to stop over in Istanbul or we had to stop here or there. Finally made it, and when we get there, and the passport control officer says, sorry, your visa is not acceptable. You have to go back. If they say that to 100 people at the airport, 100 people who came for Hajj, what do you think is going to happen at the airport? If they say that to 1,000 people, let's say they say it to 1,400 people, they say, your passport is not acceptable. You have to go back. Now, this is not kuffar telling you that. That's Muslims telling you. You can come back next year. You can come back next year. You are going to have riots at the airport. You can have microphone announcements saying, calm down everyone, calm down, please take your... Is anybody going to listen? No. There are well over, between 1,400 and 1,800 people in front of the Prophet ﷺ. They didn't take a flight with air conditioning and a flight attendant saying, would you like some more water? Would you like a hot towel? Would you like... They didn't come like that. They came through the desert. And they almost got killed several times. And now they're being told, go back home. Come next year. By the way, go back home, come next year is not even a guarantee, because who's telling you that? Your enemy is telling you that, who would love to see you dead. So they may be lying to you already. They may not honor their treaty. أُولَٰئِكَ لَا إِمَانَ لَهُمْ لَا إِمَانَ لَهُمْ These people, their oaths cannot be trusted. And they're telling you go back. And even if you did go back, is it a guarantee you can even afford to come back the next time? The people who made it all the way to Hajj, don't you think they basically used up all of their life savings to make this? This trip is not an easy trip to make, especially with somebody, these people barely had enough to eat for a day or two, and now they've got sacrificial camels that they're bringing with them. This is a huge amount of money that they spent, life savings that they spent, not only the risk that they came to make Hajj. So when they were told, go back, this is not just after a long flight, this is after attempting killing of the Prophet ﷺ, Uthman almost being killed, the Prophet ﷺ being insulted during negotiations, Abu Jandal has just come in chains, this is one of ours, he has to be taken back. If a Muslim runs away from Makkah and makes it to Medina, what's the treaty? Send him back. He can't stay, send him back. Let him go back to that in the hands of the enemy again. And we've agreed to all of this. And then the Prophet ﷺ says to them, shave your heads, let's go back, take your ihram off. And what you would expect, by the way, did the Prophet ﷺ have a microphone? That they have a mountain he can stand on top of, so when he speaks, he can his voice can be heard over everybody else's voice. No, he doesn't. He's speaking in a normal voice to thousands of people, hundreds upon hundreds upon hundreds of people that are angry like they've never been angry before, that are frustrated like they've never been frustrated before. By the way, this is not just any city. This is Makkah. These are the people who tried to kill the Prophet ﷺ 3 times in war already. 3 times within the last decade. And before then, they tried to kill him when he used to live in Makkah, and he barely escaped. So these are not just any people. So the kind of animosity and the anger that the Muslims have inside them against these people is not a normal kind of anger. And yet, when the Prophet ﷺ says to them, take your ihram off, and remember I told you yesterday that nobody got up and they all stayed quiet? Let me tell you, if you had any other group of people on earth sitting there in those circumstances, they would not be sitting quiet. Nobody would be sitting quiet. There would be a riot. There would be chaos. Nobody would be following chain of command. Everybody would be doing their own thing. There would be huge amounts of noise, yelling and screaming. There would be infighting. Some of them will say, forget this, I'm going and I'm fighting them. I'll kill them myself. All kinds of chaos would be happening. And yet, they controlled all of that, those eruptions of emotional earthquakes, those anger eruptions that you can only expect from any human being. They were not able, they didn't display any of that, and they remained calm and settled. And they just sat there quietly and not knowing what to do. Just containing that anger alone was one of the most huge accomplishments. One of the greatest accomplishments. So what does Allah say? Allah says, by the way, the fact that they didn't fight and the fact that they went back is not because they're cowards. So Allah says, Muhammadur Rasulullah, وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ أَشِدَّاءُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارِ رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ Muhammad is the messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And those who are with him, these people that are with him right now, are intense. They're tough against the disbelievers. You would imagine an ayah like this one, tough against the disbelievers, would come when we're going into battle. But this is not an ayah where we're going into battle. We're actually walking away peacefully. Allah is saying, I know how tough you are. And I know how hard it was for you this time to not fight. To not fight. And that doesn't take away how strongly you feel against these enemies. And you are merciful and loving and caring towards each other. رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ And so then Allah starts describing these people and their qualities. تَرَاهُمْ رُكَّعًا سُجَّدًا يَبْدَغُونَ فَضْلًا مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرِضْوَانًا You'll see them in ruku, in sajda. They're trying to earn special blessings from Allah. And they're trying to earn His contentment. By the way, our worship is accepted when we follow the way of our Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yes, Allah says, فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ The Prophet is told to say, follow me, Allah will love you. So if in their head, Allah will love us when we do Hajj. No, Allah will love us when we follow our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if our Prophet says, don't make Hajj, that's better for us. When our Prophet says, slaughter the animal and give the meat to these people, it's better for us. And so they're not interested in what they want, they're only interested in following what our Messenger wants, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because they know that's better for them. يَبْتَغُونَ فَضْلًا مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرِضْوَانًا They can put all of their feelings aside. And putting your feelings aside, like anger and frustration and injustice, the feeling that you've been dealt with unjustly, putting that aside is not an easy thing. But they were able to put all of that aside and just remain calm still. And so Allah says, سِيمَاهُمْ فِي وُجُوهِهِمْ مِنْ أَثَرِ السُّجُودِ You'll find the marks of sajda on their foreheads. And it also means the mark of humility. They will submit before Allah, and they understand that submitting before Allah actually means submitting before whatever decision the Prophet tells you to make, even though every cell in your body, every drop of blood in your body is going, your feelings are going against it. But your Messenger said it, and that's enough for you. You're able to control that and curb it and really put yourself, tame yourself, even though you're turning into a wild horse. And so now we get to this analogy. Allah said, ذَلِكَ مَثَلُهُمْ فِي التَّوْرَاتِ This is how they were described even in Torah. There's a remarkable gift Allah has told us that the followers of the Prophet ﷺ, they have already been described in previous scripture. Like these incredible people. وَمَثَلُهُمْ فِي الْإِنْجِيلِ And the way they are described in the Injil, in the scripture given to Jesus, is كَزَرْعٍ أَخْرَجَ شَطْأَهُ فَآزَرَهُ فَاسْتَغْلَظَ فَاسْتَوَى عَلَى سُوقِهِ Listen to this part. This is the victory of the Prophet ﷺ. He says, these people are like crop. The Bible describes these people like crop. Crop means seeds that farmer puts in the ground, zar'in. أَخْرَجَ شَطْأَهُ, it brings its blade out, like a little tiny piece of grass, comes out of the ground. فَآزَرَهُ, then it starts becoming reinforced. It reinforces itself. The little blade gets thicker and thicker, and it can stand on its own. It's not flickering in the wind, it can stand by itself now, it's getting stronger. فَاسْتَغْلَظَ, then it becomes hard and thick, meaning like the bark of a tree, right? Or a thick stem of a plant. فَاسْتَوَى عَلَى سُوقِهِ, then it stands firm on its branch. It stands tall. It's got a spine now. This is the analogy of the companions, is the analogy of a seed that turns into a tree, or turns into a tall crop. And then Allah says, يُعْجِبُ الزُّرَّاعِ, that the farmer who put it in, the farmers who put it in, are impressed with the growth, with their growth. Basically, what this is describing is how a crop matures, right? The greatest victory of the Prophet ﷺ is the maturity of his companions. It's the maturity of his companions. How much they were able to control themselves and remain firm on their faith. And it wasn't easy to do that. The Prophet ﷺ cultivated them to do that, step by step by step. To the point, you know, in the analogy, in the beginning, it's just a seed. A seed cannot take care of itself. A seed has to be watered. A seed, the soil has to be protected. Insects have to be removed. When it's a small blade, it still has to be protected and guarded. When it starts turning stronger and stronger, it can, فَاسْتَوَى عَلَى سُوقِهِ, it can stand on its own. Allah is describing these companions were so mature that even if they were all alone and there was nobody else around to support them or to give them reinforcement in their faith, they can still stand by their faith. They can still, each one of them by themselves became an ambassador of Islam. This was the greatest victory of the Prophet ﷺ, that he was able to produce people like that, that changed the world. فَاسْتَوَى عَلَى سُوقِهِ يُعْجِبُ الزُّرَّاعَ لِيَغِيظَ بِهِمُ الْكُفَّارِ, the farmer is impressed, and those the disbelievers are absolutely frustrated by these people. Understand this part of the analogy. This is the victory of the Prophet ﷺ. A nation has risen that can stand and hold on to its faith no matter what the situation outside. They will commit themselves to the faith. They don't follow the ways of society. They don't fall into peer pressure. They don't become weak on their own. They continue to find their strength in their loyalty to their Prophet ﷺ. You cannot bend them. You cannot bend these people. And when you can't bend them, disbelievers hate it, because they love people you can bend. They love people you can influence. But these people can't be influenced. Their stem is too strong. They stand on a spine, you know. The bark is thick. You know, فَاسْتَغْلَظَ فَاسْتَوَى عَلَى سُوقِهِ. So لِيَغِيظَ بِهِمُ الْكُفَّارِ. What does that mean for you and me? What it actually means is we have to continue the victory of the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I'm especially talking to young people here. Young people are considered impulsive. Young people are considered weak in their willpower. In other words, you can just show them a couple of ads and they say, man, I gotta get those shoes. Or I gotta watch that movie. Or I gotta get that kind of phone. You just give them what they should desire and they'll just run after it. Whether it's fashion or entertainment or, you know, some kind of luxury, they're just going to run after it one after the other. But if you can take those same young people and you can give them the maturity that the Prophet wants to give them sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you can mature them into this crop, then they don't go into high school and they don't go into college following other people's trends. They stand on their own. They're not trying to imitate anybody. They're not trying to impress anybody. The only one they're interested in impressing is Allah. يَبْدَغُونَ فَضْلًا مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرِضْوَانًا, in the same ayah. The only one they're interested in pursuing the favor of is Allah. So long as He's happy, I don't need to impress anybody. They don't want to fit in. They don't want to like talk the talk with anybody else. They don't look at somebody else and say, man, I wish I had that. They don't have it. They're way too mature for that. And when people see, other young people see that, they say, man, he's our age, but he's mature like he's twice our age. How is he like that? How is she like that? That came from their faith. That came from the crop that the Prophet ﷺ produces, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's the power of it. يُعْجِبُ الزُّرَّاعَ لِيَغِيظَ بِهِمُ الْكُفَّارُ وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ مِنْهُمْ مَغْفِرَةً وَأَجْرًا عَظِيمًا. Allah has promised those who've believed and those who do good deeds from among them, forgiveness and great reward. Now you tell me, what's the most important motivation to go to Hajj? Like, why does somebody want to go to Hajj? You know what you earn when you come back from a Hajj that's accepted? Forgiveness. Clean slate. Allah promised these people a clean slate. They didn't get to do Hajj, but Allah promised them forgiveness. Because what they did is actually the reason you and I are able to go to Hajj. That's the reason we're able to go to Hajj. You know, when they slaughtered those animals and they fed them to the Quraysh, they're the reason we're able to slaughter animals today and we give them in charity and eat ourselves. They're the reason we can do that. So they became the greatest victory of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I said this to you folks before in during the series when I was in Cape Town, but I'll repeat myself. Our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not leave behind skyscrapers and major highways and monuments and like pyramids, and you know other nations left these buildings behind. Our Prophet didn't leave buildings behind. Our Prophet left people behind. People that were like buildings. People whose personalities carried Islam. To this day, it carries Islam. And that's what Islam actually means, to cultivate people and to turn them into something so powerful, so independent, and so mature that society and trends and peer pressure and media, none of that stuff wavers us. It doesn't shake us. Something new comes out nowadays, and Muslims are like, how do we respond to this? How do we respond to that? A tree stands, the wind blows this way, the wind blows that way, the tree is still standing. The tree doesn't move. You know, that's what we're supposed to become. That is the victory of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That is why actually he is the final messenger. He's the final messenger because he produced people like that. Because now those people will stand tall and they have the book that will give them the strength to continue to stand tall. They won't waver again. I pray that Allah Azza wa Jal makes us the continuation of the victory of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, especially our young generation, that they learn to stand tall and understand the purpose that was handed down to them. لِيَكُونَ الرَّسُولُ شَهِيدًا عَلَيْكُمْ وَتَكُونُ شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. So the messenger could be a witness over you, and you must be witness over all humanity. You must stand tall and witness over all of humanity. And so this is actually something very heavy that Allah has given us in this profound ayah, in Inna Fatahna Laka Fatha Mubina, and this final ayah of Surah Al-Fatih. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim, wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikr al-Hakim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.